Sterilization of females is a much more complicated procedure than that of males. Second, effective garbage management. This is something, I mean, we've not been able, let's leave alone the macaques or the rats. We've not been able to regulate our own garbage management in Bangalore City. What are we going to do in other areas where there is actually wildlife feeding out of this garbage? Third, we definitely need strict legislation against provisioning in human populated sites and in protected areas. The government of India has a rule banning you from feeding monkeys, but try telling any pilgrim in any temple or the temple priest that. So it just does not work. So even though, and I think Dr. Pani raised this point beautifully, and I've always agreed with him on this, there is a great divide between legal recourses and moral recourse. And unless there's a change in our own attitudes and in our own belief systems, no amount of legislation can help us. And I think I completely agree with him there. Reactive management, we could potentially cull or capture identify troops or problem individuals and establish monkey sanctuaries. I got into a lot of trouble because about 7 or 8 years ago when the samiti came to meet me, I said, yes, if there are particular problem individuals, you can call them. Because who am I to sit in Bangalore and say, oh, no, we should conserve them, you must tolerate them. I'm not affected, it's they who are affected. And I got into a lot of trouble because there was a headline saying primatologist suggests culling of monkeys. But what I also told them is that we have to be very careful about who we cull, who we capture, can we do it as doing the way as possible, and we perhaps need expert guidance in it. But this is something that we have to deal with. It's a very difficult problem, but we need to deal with it. Second, is it possible to develop fruit belts or monkey plantations? There have been some experiments with this on the Delhi Ridge to draw the rhesus macaques away. Who will sustain them financially? Physically, who will take care of these plantations? Who will provide the money for it? The day you don't feed them, they will come into your orchard. So the problem doesn't seem to go there. One very important way in which perhaps people have tried to look at crop damage and compensation or confirmed injuries from macaque attacks is to look at insurance schemes. But again, I think there's a very important lesson that Dr. Devi Shetty told us yesterday, which is that you can truly help people not by charity, but by helping them within their means to control their own problems. If the government provides money for insurance, one day that will dry up and that will never be a permanent solution. However, I have some friends and colleagues who work with other species who've been able to establish very, very successful insurance schemes, either for livestock attacked by carnivores, such as tigers or leopards, or elephant damage of crops, and it has never been tried for the primates, where it's a self-financing insurance scheme where all the affected people put in their money and then it's distributed depending on who suffers losses. Of course, there is also incentives that they provide to each other for taking care of their crops, taking care of their livestock, and it's a long and complicated story, but in some cases at least it has worked very well, not only in terms of reimbursing people for the losses they suffer, but also to protect the species and try and conserve them when there is potentially conflict situations. Two rules that I have put in bold and which we continuously break, but we shouldn't, is first, translocation is not a solution. You're basically transferring the problem to someone else. We have learned this repeatedly through our mistakes. Of course, I told you that we always try to foist our monkeys or our problem species onto less unfortunate people or people who we think we can get away with. But there are also other problems of zoonotic diseases, of infections that urban monkeys may carry, which may go into the protected area, affect the natural populations. So translocation is never a solution and should not be practiced at any cost. The second, there have been talks about whether we can once again start exporting our rhesus macaques to other countries for scientific research, which is what had happened in the past. This is also something I'm against it because it's a runaway process. You may try doing it in a regulated fashion, but it will never work. It invariably goes underground, there's a black market in it, and finally, the population really suffers. In fact, one of the greatest debts I think, at least I personally owe to Sri Morarji Desai, was that he single-handedly banned rhesus macaque export. This was a time when thousands of rhesus monkeys were being caught every day for for supply to the United States and the Western European countries for medical research. And finally, when the population crashed, in one day, Morarji Desai took a decision saying, I ban. When people turned around and said, it's an interesting sidelight, when people turned around and asked him, what moral authority do you have to ban? Because, you know, other people are dependent on drugs that are tested on these individuals. Are you condemning the entire population? He said, I have the moral authority to do it because I've never taken ever in my life any drug that was tested on an animal. So clearly there are certain decisions that need to be taken, and I think we had a discussion on this yesterday, that sometimes we are too complacent, we are too politically correct, but sometimes you do need to take some hard decisions. There is now talk about opening up rhesus macaque export again, which I hope will not happen, because ultimately we may not be able to save the species that way. So we need a lot of research. There's ecological and behavioral plasticity of macaques that use human-modified landscapes. We need to identify the socio-ecological correlates of problem groups. And in fact, Saurabh Anand, who is a student in NIAS, working with Dr. Sindhu Radhakrishnan, is currently addressing similar kinds of problems. There is alternatives to surgical sterilization that perhaps we should look at, which is that of immunocontraceptives, which can work well because you don't, then you avoid surgery, but haven't worked so well so far. We need to understand population viability, individual mortality, social organization, behavioral profiles, following sterilization, which has never been done. We need to survey sociocultural and economic realities of people living in macaque-affected areas, except as a knee-jerk response. We haven't done this very often. We need to also understand what people feel in terms of their attitudes towards these monkeys. What does it promise for conservation of these species? In terms of management, there's effective management of the agriculture forest ecotone that we have to look at. We need to establish local and central management committees, which should include researchers as well as managers. Often there's a mismatch. People don't talk to each other, which creates a problem. Institution of regular and reliable monitoring programs for these macaques. Proper evaluation of the extent and quality of crop damage and correct documentation of macaque inflicted injuries. And public education protocols to impart knowledge about macaque behavior and appropriate rules of human-macaque interaction. This seminar was meant to talk about communication. I have not talked about it at all, but I think it's extremely important that we begin dialogues to try and explain to people not only the biology of the macaques, but also what they should be doing when they come face to face with macaques. And I've done this to a limited extent for apartment blocks in Bangalore. Also, of course, we need to develop effective long-term conservation plans for the macaques, because they are not as resilient or as hardy as we think they are. I wanted to thank a whole range of people in alphabetical order. The people in the top are people who have talked about this work, about strategies for trying to understand conservation, for rights of people. This is a group, Sajan Shujoy was working in Himachal and brought me in contact with these two organizations with which we've had a lot of dialogues. Sunita, Mohimuk and Kakuli are my long-term friends, collaborators, and have been doing the work in Bandipur. I wanted to end before lunch on with a poem. And I hope I will dissipate some of the natural science tags that I carry here as well. Many of you may have heard this infinite monkey, about this infinite monkey's meme, which says, and I'll read out in case you can't see from there, if an infinite number of monkeys randomly hit the keys of an infinite number of typewriters, would they eventually produce the complete work of Shakespeare? This is well known. So, was Shakespeare a probabilistic genius? That they did. In fact, Dr. Devi Shetty showed us an elephant painting yesterday. But there is a very nice, a very moving poem that I found by an American poet and novelist called Ronald Corday. And this is the poem, and I'll just read it out. After all the Shakespeare, the book of poems they type is the saddest in history. But before they can finish it, they have to wait for that someone who's always looking to look away. Only then can they strike the million keys that spell humiliation and grief, which are the great subjects of monkey literature, and not, as some people still believe, the banana and the tire. Thank you.
If somebody is not asking, I just mentioned to you, I live last 25 years.